And his first ball disappears all along the ground. Nicely played. 4 runs to Shane Warne.
6 more added after that Shane Warne boundary. They take it along to 262 for 6. A very valuable partnership between Steve Waugh and Shane Warne. They put on 52 by the close of play on this third evening. 82 for Steve Waugh, and that is a terrific performance, particularly considering the way in which his hand has been behaving and the pain he's so obviously in. 47 for Ian Healy. He's had a good match also. That was a very, very good little knock. 262 for 6 in the bowling figures for England. Bit of a struggle towards the end for them. Darren Goff, 16 overs for 50. Couldn't quite get through today. Headley again bowled very well. 3 for 64 from 21 overs and 3 maidens. Croft, 2 for 57. Did the job. Not much in it there. Not a great deal of spin. Certainly not as much as Shane Warne was getting. Perhaps it's to do with the pitch being one day older. Elam, 1 for 41. Again showed his worth as an all-rounder. And Caddick, none for 42. In 13. So after 3 days of this third Cornhill Test match at Old Trafford, the Australians 235 and 262 for 6, a good performance, and England out for 162. The Australians 335 runs ahead.
Removes the actor's mask to reveal the man. Omnibus, next Sunday at 10:50 on BBC One.
A hoax designed to fool the world. BBC Two's Weekend on Mars concludes in a few minutes with the tense movie thriller Capricorn One, later than advertised because of this evening's extended Wimbledon coverage. And it's film drama here on BBC One in 40 minutes. Michael Caine and Jane Fonda break down the barriers of race and join the fight against a ruthless developer in the American Deep South in Hurry Sundown. First on BBC One, the best of today's play in the third test, introduced by Richie Benno.
Looks like being a very difficult day at the office for Mike Atherton and his men. 335 runs behind Australia, who still have 4 second innings wickets in hand, including Steve Waugh's. England's batsmen know they're going to have to play a lot better in their second innings than they did in the first. Mike Taylor's Australians, well, they're raring to go. They know they have the bowlers to make life difficult for England, whatever the condition of the pitch on the last few days, and will be relishing the chance of wrapping up this game in order to square the series. Welcome to the highlights of the fourth day's play of this third Cornhill Test match at Old Trafford. We've had tremendous contests so far, some wonderful cricket, some tense stuff, and we're looking forward to more of it today. England will need an innings from Michael Atherton to match the one he played not so long ago against South Africa. The Australians, well, they've got Steve Waugh there, hoping to make history with just a few more runs to make another century in this match. This is the way it began on the fourth morning. 262 for 6, the Australians. Steve Waugh, 82 not out, and Shane Warne playing very well, unbeaten on 33. Bowling figures, the England bowlers, Goff none for 50. Headley again, a star on debut, 3 for 64, and Croft 2 for 57. Elam, 13 overs, 3 maidens, 1 for 41. I suspect just a little under bowled. Caddick none for 42, and this is the state of play. The Australians 262 for 6 and Australia 335 runs ahead. Well, it seemed to me that the pitch was easing out a little bit yesterday, but to bring us up to date on that, here's Geoffrey Boycott.
In England's first innings, Shane Warne bowled a beauty at Alex Stewart, which pitched outside leg stump and turned. Alec was playing it to the leg side, and I think that's going to be a problem for England when they have to bat today. You see, with this ball is pitched for a right-hander, these footmarks here that the bowlers have made on the follow through. This one doesn't matter, it's much too full, it's half volley. But here, this is where he tends to pitch. In these marks here, you can see where the bowlers have followed through. Here as well, a lot of stud marks as well. as the scratch mark. The ball spins, and he's a big spinner of the ball. It's okay when he pitches here, it will turn on a length on the stumps. But unless the batsmen play poor shots and follow it, like Crawley and Hussain did, I think at some stage he's going to bowl into these footmarks and create problems for the left and right-hander. And England have to make up their mind that they'll get five sessions or more to bat. Are they playing to draw the match, or are they trying to win it? Because if they get caught in two minds, then they'll get out fairly quickly. But all in all, they should be able to bat for long periods. It's slow turn, and that shouldn't be that difficult. It's a concentrate and patience, and they know exactly what they're doing, either winning the match or drawing it.
Well, it could be a long haul for both teams here. England, if they're going for a win or trying to search for a draw, and the Australians trying to bowl them out to square the series. We join play now in the first over as the third ball. Dean Headley is the bowler. Steve Waugh is taking strike.
Good stroke from Waugh. Concentrating more on survival yesterday with his bad hand, allowed Warne to dominate, which he did very well. And just started off nicely again this morning. Good chuck. And Waugh hasn't moved a muscle. Didn't even take a step towards running there. Must have come right off the meat of the bat. Would have been a lovely feel. Now that's a good shot. We'll need the third umpire there. Umpire Venkat is already talking on his walkie-talkie, his mobile. And they will want to know precisely what happened there. And umpire Venkat will realise very quickly that they ran four anyway. Pushing up towards a half century here, and a very good one too it will be if eventually reaches it.
Well, he's a dangerous player, like Ian Healy. He plays shots, you're never quite sure where to put the fielders. He certainly doesn't hang around. That's a very good hit again. Everything going well for Australia. It doesn't help England's cause, particularly the early opening batsmen, when they see the ball flying around.
Well, that's a good shot, and it's a very, very good half century for Shane Warne. He's made one previously, but this is a good effort, and exactly what Mark Taylor and Steve Waugh, for that matter, would have wanted out there this morning. Nice performance. Good slow ball and a not so good misfield. Andrew Carrick is the man. 298 for six. And the lead now for Australia, 371. See from Shane Warne. That was quite a nasty delivery from Caddick. It was only a loosener, and it took off from just short of a good length. That won't fill the early batsman for England with a great deal of confidence. Caddick is a very tall man, might have got an extra bit of bounce there.
Really took off. May have just gone away a little bit. Perhaps touched the glove on the way through. Alex Stewart's had a pretty profitable match, but Shane Warne can be happy with that. Good half century to go with his 6 wickets. He's had a good match, but I'm sure he'll be thinking it's far from finished.
That's the way it looks now with that first wicket down this morning. Warne caught Stewart by Caddick 53. 298 for 7. Steve Waugh will reckon he could have done with those.
Boundary brings up the 300. Fortuitous for Paul Rifle. Only just out of the reach of Mark Butcher.
A bit of fire there from Andrew Caddick. Again. That's what Andrew Caddick needs, some deliveries of that kind.
Yes, they're both bouncing and moving away off the seam.
And there it is. Loud applause around the ground and long chase to the fielder. Steve Waugh eases his way through to a second century in the match. Simple acknowledgement, rather shy look toward the ground, mops the brow. And the shake of the hand. But the demeanour scarcely reflects the magnitude of the achievement here at Old Trafford. So, 2 centuries in an Ashes Test match. First player to score a century in both innings of an Ashes Test match is 1947. That was Arthur Morris and Dennis Compton.
Catch it!
Ouch. Well, that really hurt Butcher, fielding a silly point in front of the bat there.
Yes, it's the last thing you need to do when you're going to have to bat for probably 5 sessions to save a test match or even contemplate trying to win it, to lose one of your opening batsmen because of an injured wrist while fielding it silly mid-off.
That's very well fielded, and a great throw. But they steal a single. Marvellous bit of fielding, and I suppose you'd say, well, it was all done right-handed. Still looking rather cautiously at that left wrist. Well, he put a bit of weight in it just as he slid to the ground there.
I always think that's one of the great incentives for staying on the field and keeping well away from the physio. That's that spray. I think that hurts more than the actual blow itself.
That's a good stop. Dean Headley at mid-off. Long way down for a tall man, but he did that very well indeed. Not the easiest bounce.
Nice use of the feet. And Steve Waugh just getting underneath that one. Didn't quite hit it perfectly, but there's certainly enough bat on it. And Robert Croft deposited over mid-wicket for four. Now, there is a man out there at deep cover, but even he can't get to that one.
This is an overcompensation ball here. He bowled it straight, got hit into the deep, so he's bowled it outside off stump with a bit of width, and it was a little bit full as well.
Now, time for a change in the bowling at the Stretford end. Dean Headley invited once again to take the ball. That's out. Well, finally, it all comes to an end. Good delivery from Dean Headley, just a little extra bounce once again. Has got that ability to find something in a pitch which seems to be playing quite placidly. And an almost involuntary stab at the ball from Steve Waugh. Just deflected it into the gloves of Alex Stewart. So good reward for Dean Headley. But no mistaking the man of the moment. Number 10 for Australia, Jason Gillespie. So the eighth wicket is down for 333. Just dropping short. Well, Nasser Hussain involved in that somewhat controversial dismissal earlier yesterday, but the catch that got rid of Greg Blewett, this one definitely didn't carry. You can see the table of those highest fourth innings winning totals. India West Indies 75-76. Some of those go back an awful long way, but basically will be a monumental effort if England even get close to that. Oh, so close again. Well, this is almost the stock delivery for Dean Headley, getting the ball to swing back into the right-handers. This is the one he's really got the hang of, and the line was pretty much perfect. The length was near perfect. So close that time. That's a great delivery. Every now and again this morning we've seen the ball just do that little bit extra, bounce and carry through like this.
We're getting into a situation where the declaration is say imminent, but it's reasonably close.
Andrew Caddick was putting in the short ones around there. Going to miss leg stump, but not by much. Well, it could have been bad, but indeed it was. It wasn't all that far from Alex Stewart. 430 the lead. The man going back to deep backward square at the moment. Headley has used that field placing when he's using reverse swing, which is what he tried for there, but it was a little bit too straight. Certainly the ball slanted in from outside the off stump, but Jason Gillespie got it away very nicely. Croft is going to bowl, and it'll be one of the longest overs of off-spinning you've seen for a while. Robert Croft is just pulling a few grass seeds out of the ball there, just cleaning a bit of dust off it. He weren't too pleased about that. he was just jigging around there and having a bit of fun, if that's the correct terminology, with Paul Rifle, and it's cost him four runs.
So the Australians continue batting, and well, they certainly have enough runs by our estimation, though we've seen from Steve Waugh and others that they've certainly had a chance to play some shots out there, and it's been very difficult for the bowlers to get any sort of penetration.
That's just cleared, Alex Stewart. Gone for four, too. It was helped round again off the glove with just enough impetus to take it wide and over the head of the keeper. Catch it. Oh! Almost a little bit of Paul Daniels magic from Andy Caddick. Was pretty firmly struck. It was the old, oh, get the hand down, try and run it up the arm, and oh, what a pity. That's well struck. That's two or three bounces and over the boundary. It's wide mid-on. Fine shot, really, and it brings up the 50 partnership between these two. This has the feel of an end of innings over, but we'll have to wait and see. That's a very good shot. Dean Headley was positioned out there at deep mid-wicket. Caddick is behind square at square leg. And that one intentionally placed well between them and also hit very sweetly out of the meat of the bat.
Well, four more runs were added to take it along to 395 for eight. That's an outstanding scoreboard for Australia, with Steve Waugh making 116. And the tail really wagged. Ian Healy, 47, Shane Warne, 53, and Paul Rifle and Jason Gillespie, an excellent partnership there. Rifle, 45, and Gillespie, 28. 20 extras, 395 for eight when the declaration came from Mark Taylor. Then Goff, none for 62. Headley, 4 for 104, 8 wickets for him in the match. Croft, 2 for 105. Elam, 1 for 41. Caddick, 1 for 69. This is the state of play when England begin their second innings. The Australians, 468 runs ahead, and only two teams have ever made over 400 in the fourth innings to win a test match. They're plenty ahead of England there. And we're going to join them now with three runs on the board. Jason Gillespie is the bowler. Mark Butcher is the man taking strike.
Likes to play the ball square, gets on top of it well this time. No great speed, but they run three. Well, he's clattered that away, absolutely clattered it. Certainly it's a positive approach from England. That confidence is important whether you're trying to win a match or whether you're trying to save the match.
Well, you don't have to bowl too often there to Michael Atherton. Just a normal afternoon's batting for him. Picks up three runs. The outfield at Old Trafford has not been quick at all here. Lots of threes. Well, that was well bowled because it absolutely surprised Michael Atherton. It's very strange indeed, but it did. He did well to get his gloves and bat underneath the bounce there. Runs this time. Played well down, and that races away. That'll probably get to the boundary. The cheer tells the story.
Nicely stroked away. It was just a defensive push, but they're going to get, well, they get three if they wanted.
First delivery from Shane Warne. First run off Shane Warne. That's gone very high and carried for six. Well, Mike Latherton dismissed in the first innings playing the hook shot. The big difference here is, whereas it was a bit of glove first time round, this is meat of the bat. They're asking the question now, what's that come via? Because Mark Butcher was looking to leave the ball.
Now that was, or appeared to be, a bit of a con job. The gloves and the bat were well out of the way. So off the leg, onto the elbow.
That's got him. That's cut low, straight enough. Jason Gillespie has broken through. That's the first England wicket to fall. It's the captain, Mike Latherton.
Yes, that ball only bouncing about half stump high, even though Atherton is a little bit off the ground as he's playing it. It's still well and truly below Bale height, and Atherton a long way across. Absolutely no doubt about where that one was going to finish its journey.
England are 44 for one. Oh, that's just what Shane Warne wanted. Alex Stewart all at sea. And the old adage has worked. One brings two.
Stewart was looking for the leg break, and Shane Warne found the hole to take his 250th wicket. And he's got there pretty quickly. 55 test matches for Shane Warne to take his 250 test wickets.
Oh. Nicely played, timed and placed. Just stay there. Two runs enough at this stage. First ball of the final test of the day, flicked away down to Glenn McGrath for one, brings up the England 50. That's got in, that was close enough for umpire Venkatragovan. And so, Jason Gillespie having a good day this afternoon. The wickets of Mike Latherton and now Nasser Hussain, two of England's finest. I'm just wondering about that decision against Nasser Hussain. Now, I'll have a look from the stump camera. I just got a suspicion that's marginally outside our stump when it hits him. Very pleasant looking shot from Graham Thorpe. Three for him. That's gone high in the air. Will Glenn McGrath get there? Oh, yes. Well, he just made it. Well, in the end, that goes down as a fantastic catch. He had to make quite a lot of ground in from long leg. Mark Butcher got right underneath it. And in the end, Glenn McGrath took it right on the ground.
Well, I think this is the moment of truth for John Crawley, because he really needs some runs in this Test series.
Butcher gone for 28.
Went like a flash into the gully. A little bit of extra bounce on this occasion for Gillespie, and because Crawley tries to play it with the straight bat, it's a very difficult shot to keep down with a straight bat. Much easier to hit the horizontal bat shot, get over the top of it. Went in the air, went very quickly. Better placed, nicely timed too. And that really is racing away to the mid-wicket boundary. Much better stroke. Good shot. Well placed. Is he going to make it? It does. It's Mark Waugh out there. It looked for a moment as if there wasn't quite enough strength and timing in the stroke. Oh. Well, that nearly decapitated Ian Healy. Goes down as two byes, but there's a lot of activity there.
As we see, this one spin quite sharply and bounce, really bounce, no wonder. Healy couldn't get a glove on that. He's lucky he didn't lose his front teeth.
Ah! And that's it. It was wide, it was quicker, might have been a top spinner, and Thorpe so caged in there and so much concerned about padding away, suddenly flashes the bat at it, tries to play a shot, and nicks it to the keeper. .84/5, and I think that Mark Taylor's theory about dispiriting the opposition by batting for an extraordinarily long time may have a bit of merit.
That's beautifully played, though. That was right up there for hitting. John Crawley made no mistake. Just a little ray of sunshine as far as England are concerned. Ball toss, not quite such a problem though, and that's been nicely timed. Oh! Well, that one really did go like a firecracker.
I don't know how you play this. I mean, with the greatest of difficulty. Oh, that nearly went at right angles.
Oh! Well, that's just a whisker away again. One run, it's enough to bring England up to the 100 mark. Some small consolation. The key figure is the 5 to the right of the total. 100/5 for England. Ball toss is welcomed. dispatched for four. Once again, that's beaten the lot. Spinning from outside leg stump, ending up on the line of a finish third man.
It's another good shot. Just about one and over. There's a loose one from Michael Bevan. He's bowled some cracking deliveries as well. Stroke. Nicely timed and beautifully placed. Good D for John Crawley.
Five more added to take it along to 130 for five at the close of play on this fourth evening, and that was an excellent half century from John Crawley, 53 not out for him, and good stern resistance from Mark Elam, five not out, doesn't look much, but he was there for an hour, and he gave Crawley tremendous support, and England will need plenty more of that tomorrow, 130 for five for them, a good opening stand, and then not much else after that until Crawley came along. Jason Gillespie, I thought, bowled brilliantly today. 12 overs, 4 maidens, 3 for 31. There wasn't much there for him in the pitch. And he really bent his back and got two very fast deliveries through for those LBWs. And Shane Warne, 19 overs, 7 maidens and 2 for 21. Quite dramatic bowling figures there. Now this is the situation at the close of play on the fourth day. England, 162 and 130 for 5. Against the Australians and their declaration 395 for 8 earlier in the day, and England need 339 more runs to win. So a great performance there from Shane Warne to bowl Australia perhaps not to the brink of victory but certainly on the way, and here he is now talking with Simon Hughes.
You seem to almost impose a sort of hypnosis on the batsmen today and a little bit in the first innings.
Yeah, that's when Mark Waugh came up to me and said, geez, I don't know what shot I'd play. So if Mark Waugh's saying that sort of thing, you know, he's a very talented player. And, you know, it's always interesting out there because, I mean, I do a big hard spun leg break into the rough and it goes straight. Now the next one, you don't try and put as much spin on it and it turns square. So it's, sometimes it is quite difficult for the batters. But, you know, I thought John Crawley played outstandingly well today. He was very good in his shot selection and picked the right ball to sweep and the right ones not to. And, you know, he's very good credit to him. He played well.
Now, assuming you polish England off, which I'm sure you probably will, you're off home. You're not going to try and get another mystery ball back in Australia, are you?
No, I mean, you know, it's not over yet. We've got half the job done. England have shown a lot of fight this series so far, and there's some very good players down below. So we're going to have to work just as hard tomorrow to hopefully get those last 5 wickets. And, yeah, hopefully it'll be nice to go home and see my wife and baby, and with a win under the belt, it'll be nice.
A little bit of R&R for Shane Warne after this match, no matter what happens on the final day tomorrow. Here's Ian Chappell now with Geoffrey Boycott and their ideas on what might take place tomorrow.
The day for me belonged to Steve Waugh, a memorable and outstanding performance by him, and then the Australians just grinding down England.
Yeah, Steve Waugh is a remarkable test cricketer, a very dogged test cricketer, not much emotion, but boy, he gets the job done for Australia. And Australia owe him a lot. He's probably going to help them claim this victory, but he's put them in a position to win a lot of test matches lately. Terrific test match for him.
But then what about the England batting later on? I mean, you're expecting Shane Warne to be the bogeyman. England lost 3 wickets to seam as 3 top men to seam bowling on that pitch.
I think in this test match, England batsmen seem to be like the rabbit caught in the headlights. You know, they've just frozen, suddenly they stopped playing shots. It was Glenn McGrath who shut things down in the first innings. Shane Warne came on and did the damage. And again in this innings, you know, they suddenly the shots dry up, the runs dry up, and you're in trouble once you're not scoring runs.
Well, I think the England batsmen have just lost the way in this test match. They started positively at the beginning of the series, but not anymore.
Only the mopping up to do, Geoffrey.
Yes.
Well, not quite mopping up yet. Still 5 to go. And Ian Chappell sounding pretty confident there. Geoffrey Boycott
not quite so. We'll be back here at Old Trafford to bring you what is happening on the final day. BBC One at 10:50 a.m. And we leave you with Steve Waugh today, the first man in Ashes cricket for the past 50 years to hit 100 in each innings of a match. A brilliant performance, and he deserved every moment of the standing ovation he was given as he left the field.